Hello, welcome to Let's Read the Books of Skyrim. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading 2920 Rain's Hand, Volume 4, which I found right here in Falion's house in Morthal. Rain's Hand, Book 4 of 2920, The Last Year of the First Era, by Korlovac Townway. Third, Rain's Hand, 2920, Cold Harbor, Oblivion. Sothasil proceeded as quickly as he could through the blackened halls of the palace, half submerged in brackish water. All around him, nasty gelatinous creatures scurried into the reeds. Burst of white fire lit up the upper arches of the hall before disappearing, and smells assaulted him, rancid death one moment, sweet flowered perfume the next. Several times he had visited the Daedra princes in their oblivion, but every time something different awaited him. He knew his purpose and refused to be distracted. Eight of the more prominent Daedra princes were awaiting him in the half-melted, domed room. Azura, Prince of Dusk and Dawn. Boethia, Prince of Plots. Hermar Mora, Daedra of Knowledge. Hersine, the Hunter. Malakath, God of Curses. Maroons Dagon, Prince of Disaster. Molag Bal, Prince of Rage. Sheogorath, the Mad One. Above them, the sky cast tormented shadows upon the meeting. Fifth, Rain's Hand, 2920, The Isle of Arteum, Somerset. Sothasil's voice cried out, echoing from the cave, "Move the rock!" Immediately the initiates obeyed, rolling aside the great boulder that blocked the entrance to the dreaming cavern. Sothasil emerged, his face smeared with ash, weary. He felt he had been away for months, years, but only a few days had transpired. Lalatha took his arm to help him walk, but he refused her help with a kind smile and a shake of his head. "Were you successful?" she asked. "The Daedra princes I spoke with have agreed to our terms," he said flatly. "Disasters such as befell Gilverdale should be averted. Only through certain intermediaries, such as witches or sorcerers, will he answer the call of man and myrrh." "And what did you promise them in return?" asked the Nord boy, Welleg. "The deals we make with Daedra," said Sothasil, continuing on to Iacessus's palace to meet with the master of the Sigic Order, "should not be discussed with the innocent." Eighth, Rain's Hand, 2920, The Imperial City, Cyrodiil. A storm belted the windows of the prince's bedchamber, bringing a smell of moist air to mix with the censers filled with burning incense and herbs. "A letter has arrived from the Empress, your mother," said the courier, "anxiously inquiring after your health." "What frightened parents I have," laughed Prince Julak from his bed. "It is only natural for mother to worry," said Severian Chorak, the potentate's son. "There is everything unnatural about my family, Akavir. My exiled mother fears that my father will imagine me of being a traitor, covetous of the crown, and is having me poisoned." The prince sank back into his pillow, annoyed. "The emperor has insisted on me having a taster for all my meals, as he does." "There are many plots," agreed the Akavir. "You have been abed for nearly 3 weeks with every healer in the Empire shuffling through like a slow ballroom dance. At least all can see that you're getting stronger." "Strong enough to lead the vanguard against Morrowind soon, I hope," said Julek. Eleventh Rain's Hand, 2920, The Isle of Arteum, Somerset. The initiates stood quietly in a row along the Arbor Loggia, watching the long, deep, marble-lined trench ahead of them flash with fire. The air above it vibrated with the waves of heat. Though each student kept his or her face sturdy and emotionless, as a true Sigic should, their terror was nearly as palpable as the heat. Sothasil closed his eyes and uttered the charm of fire resistance. Slowly he walked across the basin of leaping flames, climbing to the other side, unscathed. Not even his white robe had been burned. The charm is intensified by the energy you bring to it, by your own skills, just as all your spells are, he said. Your imagination and your willpower are the keys. There is no need for a spell to give you resistance to air or resistance to flowers, and after you cast a charm, you must forget that there is even a need for a spell to give you resistance to fire. Do not confuse what I am saying. Resistance is not about ignoring the fire's reality. You will feel the substance of flame, the texture of it, its hunger, and even the heat of it, but you will know that it will not hurt or injure you. The students nodded, and one by one, they cast a spell and made the walk through the fire. Some even went so far as to bend over and scoop up a handful of fire and feed it air, so it expanded like a bubble and melted through their fingers. Suthasil smiled. They were fighting their fear admirably. The chief proctor, Thargaleth, came running from the arbor arches. Suthasil, Amalexia has arrived in Arteum. Iakesis told me to fetch you. Suthasil turned to Thargaleth for only a moment, but he knew instantly from the screams what had transpired. The Nord lad Wellig had not cast the spell properly and was burning. The smell of scorched hair and flesh panicked the other students who were struggling to get out of the basin, pulling him with them, but the incline was too steep away from the entry points. With a wave of his hand, Suthasil extinguished the flame. Wellig and several other students were burned, but not badly. The sorcerer cast a healing spell on them, before turning back to Thargaleth. I'll be with you in a moment, and give Almalexia the time to shake the road dust from her train. Suthasil turned back to the students, his voice flat. Fear does not break spells, but doubt and incompetence are the great enemies of any spellcaster. Master Wellig, you will pack your bags. I'll arrange for a boat to bring you to the mainland tomorrow morning. The sorcerer found Almalexia and Iakesis in the study, drinking hot tea and laughing. She was more beautiful than he had remembered, though he had never before seen her so disheveled, wrapped in a blanket, dangling her damp, long black tresses before the fire to dry. At Sothasil's approach, she leapt to her feet and embraced him. "Did you swim all the way from Morrowind?" he smiled. "It's pouring rain from Skywatch down to the coast," she explained, returning his smile. "Only a half a league away, and it never rains here," said Iakesis proudly. "Of course, I sometimes miss the excitement of Somerset, and sometimes even the mainland itself. Still, I'm always very impressed by anyone out there who gets anything accomplished. It's a world of distractions." "Speaking of distractions, what's all this I hear about a war?" "You mean the one that's been bloodying the continent for the last 80 years, Master?" asked Suthasil, amused. "I suppose that's the one I mean," said Iakesis, with a shrug of his shoulders. "How is that war going?" "We will lose it, unless I can convince Suthasil to leave Arteum," said Almalexia, losing her smile. She had meant to wait and talk to her friend in private, but the old Altmer gave her courage to press on. "I have had visions. I know it to be true." Suthasil was silent for a moment, and then looked at Iakesis. "I must return to Morrowind." "Knowing you, if you must do something, you will," sighed the old master. "The Sijik's way is not to be distracted. Wars are fought, empires rise and fall. You must go, and so must we." "What do you mean, Iakesis? You're leaving the island?" "No, the island will be leaving the sea," said Iakesis, his voice taking on a dreamy quality. "In a few years, the mists will move over Arteum, and we will be gone. We are counselors by nature, and there are too many counselors in Tamriel as it is. No, we will go, and return when the land needs us again, perhaps in another age." The old Altmer struggles to his feet, and drained the last sip of his drink before leaving Suthasil and Almalexia alone. Don't miss the last boat. The year continues in Second Seed. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Skyrim, 2920, Rain's Hand, Volume 4.